Hello, I'm Anthony Coulls, Senior Curator at the National Rail Museum, and welcome to Curator with a Camera. Today, we're going to look at the pioneering engineering legend that is Stephenson's rocket. In the autumn of 1829, Rocket was a world leader. It was pushing the boundaries of how far the steam engine technology had gone. It sets the DNA for the modern steam locomotive, the conventional steam locomotive, in the UK and across the world for the next 130 years. So how does Rocket come to be? Well, Rocket is built by George and Robert Stephenson in Newcastle in 1829 to take part in the Rainhill Trials. And the Rainhill Trials was something that was put together by the promoters of the Liverpool and Manchester Railway to prove as to whether locomotives were the best option for their railway. So this engine was made to run for a number of days in October 1829 under set conditions. It had to be under 5 tons in weight. It had to consume its own smoke from the chimney. It had to burn coke, and they had to perform a set number of runs over a set number of distance, and the amount of coal and water that was used for its efficiency was also measured. So Rocket won against Sans Pareil, against novelty, and this is the beginning of the mainline railway. The Liverpool and Manchester Railway is the first railway between two cities to carry common goods and people. But Rocket stands for so much more than just a pioneer, a world leader. And it looked like this drawing over here that we have on the wall, or very similar to it. But you'd be forgiven for thinking, well, if that's what Rocket looked like in 1829 when it was new, how come it ends up looking like this? This is Rocket changed from a prize winner into a workhorse. In its short working life, it had 4 accidents and it managed to kill an MP. Those accidents contributed to the rebuildings that made it into this machine that we have on display at the museum. We like in Curator with a Camera to go and have a look at the nuts and bolts and the nitty-gritty of our collection, and Rocket really lays its parts bare for us. So in front of me, I think the main part for Rocket is the boiler. It has a multi-tubular boiler. And Henry Booth suggested to George Stephenson that they put a boiler of this design onto Rocket. The tubes increase the heating surface, so they mean that the gases that are made in this currently non-existent firebox pass through the water effectively and heat as much water as possible to make steam in that boiler, which then goes to make the engine work. At the top of the boiler, on the back of it, is a regulator valve, and that's a plug valve. It's the on-off switch that enables the steam to pass down these pipes into the cylinders, the steam cylinders, which are then connected via another absent piece, the connecting rod, which is not connecting today. And those pistons in this cylinder here are driven backwards and forwards by steam pressure down through this joint, the crosshead. And then there would be a rod there between the crosshead and the crank pin, and that drives the locomotive along. So that's the second of Rocket's innovations. It's the directly connected cylinder and wheels. Hackworth's engines, Sans Pareil, Royal George, they all had this as well, but they didn't have that effective boiler. And then the final piece of the jigsaw is also missing, sadly, with Rocket, and it's the exhaust pipes that would take the exhaust steam from the cylinders there and the steam chest along the outside of the boiler and then up through the chimney to increase the draft and pull the air through that fire and make the fire burn hotter, makes it burn brighter, and it enables the engine to make steam as it drives along. But Rocket's driving wheels here propel it to At first, amazing speeds during the trials, averaging 15, 18, 19 miles an hour. But Stephenson, ever the showman, asks for the engine at one point to have all the carriages taken off the back, and he lets the engine fly, and it runs at 35 miles an hour. That is unprecedented speeds. It's faster than the horses could run at the time. It's faster than anyone had ever been before. It's quite possibly the first land speed record, but Mr. Guinness wasn't around to verify it. But as we said, Rocket was made to win the Rainhill Trials. It wasn't made to enter service on a day-in, day-out basis, pulling passengers and goods. So it wasn't very practical. At the front, there wasn't this big drum here, this smoke box. There was just the chimney, the white chimney coming out the front end of the boiler. Of course, that clogged up with soot and ash, and the engine, again, couldn't breathe properly. So what you see here is a much later modification. This was put on after one of Rocket's accidents when it was rebuilt. In fact, this is at least its second smoke box. We believe that this was put on around 1836. And it collects the ash and the cinders. There's a door there to enable the tubes to be cleaned within the boiler. And then down below us here at the front end is an ash door so that the cinders and the ash could be collected at the end of the run or at the end of the day. And here on the front is a buffer beam. Once again, Rocket would not have had this in 1829. Number one. Now, that's not number one of the Liverpool-Manchester Railway, but refers to Rocket's afterlife with the Brampton Railway in Cumbria. After Rocket in 1830, the Liverpool-Manchester Railway ordered another four Rocket-type engines. So really, by 1836, Rocket is obsolete. So it's sold by the Liverpool and Manchester Railway in 1836 to Lord Carlisle's Railway at Brampton in Cumbria, and it becomes a colliery engine. And there it is, number one. But these are the genuine letters from the time, the numbers and letters, and the colouring even as well. You can just see there on the top of that bolt head, green, because Rocket by this time, by 1836, was painted green. We have a coloured drawing of it in the collection. Pretty much, we reckon, as prepared for when the engine was to be sold. What else happened to it? Well, as a result of another of those accidents, there was the chance to lower these cylinders. The drawing you can see on the wall behind us there, that has the cylinders are set at 45 degrees angle, driving onto the wheels. That was great, but it was reasonably unstable. The engine didn't come off the track because of it, but it wasn't a comfy ride. So instead of being 45 degrees, after one of the accidents, the engine had the cylinders set lower at an 8-degree angle, which was a much smoother action. So it was kinder to the driver and fireman, also kinder to the track. It's a piece of kit. It's a machine to do a job. That job evolved, and the machine evolved with it. Lord Carlisle gives his lease of the collieries to his agent, James Thompson of Kirkhouse. And James Thompson becomes Rocket's final owner. And when the engine works its last commercial train, he puts it into a shed and keeps it as a pet. And Rocket begins to go to pieces, quite literally. Although it's put into a shed and stored, things start to go missing. So the connecting rods have gone. Perhaps the biggest thing to go, how should we put it, walkies with this engine is the firebox on the back. So no wonder it goes walkies, because it's copper, it's valuable, and somebody can make money out of it. But a lot of other fittings go as well, and all the wooden boiler cladding has gone, and Rocket by 1851 is very much a shadow of its former self. And eventually, Rocket's significance was recognised by the new curators of what was to become the Science Museum. It was given a slightly peculiar restoration, and parts were fitted wrongly. There were wooden connecting rods made. There was an exhaust pipe placed along where they thought it should go, and a new chimney placed on the top, with sort of petals as Rocket initially had when it was new, and a wooden facsimile firebox put over the back in that gap. Over the decades, some of these false parts were taken off, some of them rotted, some of them fell off. So what is there original of Rocket? Actually, there's quite a lot that still is Rocket. So the frame plates here underneath, and the connecting motion for the valve gear. You know, that's the heart of an engine. Those frame plates, without it, it doesn't exist. But a lot of the other bits and pieces on it, so this wheel set here, and the chimney with the wire spark arrestor on the top, those are additions of later Science Museum curators and teams. But in essence, the rest of it is all Rocket, but Rocket from different periods. There is undoubtedly a very much lived-in example of this engine's life, the nameplate. Vestigial, bent, battered, tattered, but it's still Rocket. But what of Rocket's place in history? What of this slightly tired, ratty, black lump? I have seen it in correspondence that people have written to me and said, you know, Anthony, this engine is no use at all because it can't pull a train. You know, it doesn't deserve a place in the National Railway Museum. Well, actually it does, because this engine stands for the triumph of the steam locomotive in the 1830s. This engine stands for the beginning of the growth of the railway revolution, the railway network across the world, but also the engineering industry, the locomotive building industry, not just as an engine that won the Rainhill Trials, but as the steam locomotive that set the standard, set the DNA, as it were, for every commercial steam locomotive in the UK for the next 130 years. Thanks for joining us for today's Curator with a Camera look at Stephenson's Rocket. If you've enjoyed it, why not like, share, and subscribe so you don't miss out on future episodes of Curator with a Camera.